Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Car Crazy, the battle for supremacy between Ford and Olds in the dawn of the automobile age, by Gene Wayne Miller, narrated by Don Hagen. Introduction. Since my first car, an old black Ford sedan that I drove in high school, I have owned more than 10 automobiles. That qualifies me as a motorist. But until this audiobook, I was not alone in believing the U.S. car industry essentially began with Henry Ford's Model T, introduced in 1908. I thought that iconic vehicle, and a few others made by a handful of fellow manufacturers, began the profound transformation of American society that has culminated in our way of life today. The Model T, indeed, was revolutionary, but it wasn't first. Oldsmobile founder Ransom Eli Olds built his first car, a three-wheeled thing steered with a tiller and powered by a steam engine, in 1887. The first U.S. vehicle intended for sale was demonstrated in 1893 in Springfield, Massachusetts. Ford drove the first automobile he made, a box-like contraption on big bicycle tires, through the streets of Detroit in 1896. Many others in America and Europe, where the auto industry really began, were also building cars, or planning to. Then, between 1900 and 1908, more than 500 domestic car makers went into business. Competition was brutal. The vast majority of firms failed, and a colorful cast of characters abounded. Heroes, villains, schemers, and visionaries. The people who imagined a wondrous future with the automobile. That future, as we know today, was both blessing and curse. By the dawn of what would be called the American century, the car was already causing unprecedented turmoil, and it intensified during that first decade of the 1900s, the period I primarily chronicle in this audiobook. Car enthusiasts battled car haters in courts, in legislatures, and on the roads. Farmers, spooked by the evil new machines, defended their terrified horses, sometimes with shotguns and threats of murder. Motorists ridiculed the horse as filthy and useless, and the old-fashioned farmer as ignorant. Rowdies stoned Gilded Age aristocrats as they flaunted their high-priced imports on the streets of Manhattan. The police chase, the hit-and-run, and the fatal accident became staples of a dramatic new journalistic genre. The car wars, between one manufacturer and another, one driver and another, between pedestrian and horse and machine, between bucolic past and engine-powered future, played out in the trade journals and the general circulation newspapers, in the countryside and in urban centers, in most states and in many cities, especially New York City, the early heart of the car market and the nation's media capital, then as now. These battles were personified in one of the longest and most expensive lawsuits in the history of American business, the Selden patent case, which pitted Ford against the cutthroat executive Frederic L. Smith, who took over Oldsmobile in 1904. That story is a central narrative of this audiobook. And the car wars deeply involved the three main companies whose stories are told in Car Crazy. Oldsmobile, the most successful U.S. car manufacturer of the early era, Buick, which became General Motors, GM, thanks to William C. Durant, one of the most creative and daring, if now largely forgotten, figures in automotive history, and Ford Motor Company, built by an obsessed genius who rose from humble beginnings to industry dominance and great personal wealth. The roots of Car Crazy lie in the season I spent following NASCAR's premier racing series, embedded in legendary Jack Roush's Ford Racing Team, now Roush Fenway Racing, for my 2002 book, Men in Speed. At some point, I learned about a storied race between two automobiles from Manhattan to Portland, Oregon, in 1905. The cars were two-seat curved dash vehicles, built without sides, roof, or windshield, and steered with a tiller, not a steering wheel. Their gas engines generated 7 horsepower, roughly equivalent to a lawnmower today. They had a top speed of about 20 miles per hour. Although many thoroughfares in major cities were paved, beyond them there were few hard-surfaced roads or streets in the vast American landscape these cars had traveled across, particularly in the West, and rain turned the trails and stagecoach routes to nearly impassable mud. Maps were scarce, so was gasoline. Years later, as I began to contemplate writing this book, I wondered how this race, conducted years before I thought there even was an American car industry, had come to pass. Who were the drivers, and how did their primitive cars manage to make the distance? As I looked deeper into the competition, it became clear just how crazy the idea had been. But what also began to come into focus was a fascinating, largely untold story of the earliest years of the automobile industry, and the beginning of a technological, social, and cultural upheaval that would fundamentally change America and the lives of its people. I hope you enjoy the ride. G. Wayne Miller, Providence, Rhode Island. One. Fastest Man on Earth. The 999 and Arrow. It was a time when sane people did crazy things. Henry Ford was one of those people. On January 9, 1904, on the shore of frozen Anchor Bay, Lake St. Clair, some 30 miles northeast of Detroit, he vowed to be the first person to drive 100 miles per hour. The possibility that he might spin out of control and be killed as he roared across the ice did not deter him. It did, however, attract a crowd. Ford had deliberately scheduled his attempt for a Saturday, when kindly employers gave their workers the afternoon off. Then he'd created publicity that had filled the Detroit papers all week, mesmerizing a city that had already begun to thrum with the business of motors. A brilliant inventor and engineer, Ford was also a skilled marketer. He knew that machine-powered speed excited many people unlike anything before, and that word of the latest spectacle sent consumers to dealers, where they could buy an automobile of their own. He knew also that cars angered and alienated other people, the horse-bound traditionalists, but with time, he believed, almost everyone would come around. Henry Ford of the Ford Motor Works of Detroit will attempt to lower the world's record, read the handbills Ford had arranged to be posted. The race will cover over a 4-mile straight track on the ice opposite the Hotel Chesterfield. The snow will be cleared from the ice and the track will be sanded. The races will start at 2 o'clock and continue until Mr. Ford lowers the world's record. He proposes to make a mile in 36 seconds. That would greatly eclipse the existing auto record of 84.732 miles per hour, set in 1903. It conceivably would be faster than anyone had ever moved. The claimed land speed record was 112.5 miles per hour by the crew of a locomotive on May 10, 1893, on a stretch of Cornelius Vanderbilt's mighty New York Central Railroad. But in this era, so rife with tall tales, doubt existed that the train, the 999, had really traveled faster than about 90 miles per hour. Nonetheless, the train had generated international headlines, and Ford, hoping to capitalize on its enduring fame, named one of the 2 identical race cars that he built after it. Like that 62-ton locomotive, Ford's 999 racer and its twin, Arrow, the machine that Ford had brought to frozen Lake St. Clair, were essentially monster motors on wheels, producing as much as 80 horsepower, 10 or more times the power of many stock models, built to speed and speed alone, wrote the Automobile and Motor Review. Many in the crowd knew about Ford, this slightly built 40-year-old man with the piercing gray eyes, prominent nose, and long, thin hands, who seemed always to have a sly grin on his lips. He had been building and driving horseless carriages around Detroit since 1896, when American-built cars were little more than a dream, and had founded and then left two other companies before incorporating a third, the Ford Motor Company, on June 16, 1903. Son of a farmer, raised on a farm outside Detroit, Ford should have been destined to till the land, like so many of his 19th-century peers. But even as a young child, his father's tools fascinated him more than horses or fields, and by the time he turned teenager, machines had become his obsession. At first, it was unpowered machines, the watches and clocks he taught himself to take apart and repair. And then, not long after, he saw his first steam engine. The operator took the time to explain its mechanizations to the boy, and thus was Ford's true destiny revealed to him. Many in the shivering crowd also already knew about Ford's race cars from the man who had steered several of them to national headlines, Barney Oldfield, the greatest American race car driver of the early era, a man even more daring than Ford. A champion bicyclist at age 16, Oldfield had never driven a motor vehicle of any kind until Ford, seeking publicity for his second attempt at an auto company, asked him to race the 999 in a competition. At the time, Ford himself was leery of driving it, except on the test track. Saying he would try anything once, Oldfield, 24, agreed. Ford entered the 999 in the October 1902 Manufacturer's Challenge Cup at Detroit's Grosse Pointe Blue Ribbon Track, venerable home of harness racing, and set about acquainting Oldfield with the car's quirky features. "It took us only a week to teach him to drive," Ford later recalled. The man did not know what fear was. All that he had to learn was how to control the monster, meaning specifically how to gun it through corners without rolling over. The steering wheel had not yet been thought of, Ford recalled. "On this one, I put a two-handed tiller, for holding the car in line required all the strength of a strong man." While Ford was cranking the 999 to life, Oldfield said, "Well, this chariot may kill me, but they will say afterward that I was going like hell when she took me over the bank." He did go like hell, winning that October 1902 race against the already legendary automaker and racer Alexander Winton, who until then was thought to be invincible. In the summer of 1903, Oldfield drove Ford's Aero to world records at Midwest Fairgrounds, and then on July 25th at a track in Yonkers, New York. A few weeks later, he raced again at Grosse Pointe. He had just passed the leader when a tire exploded and Aero plowed into a fence, killing a spectator from Ohio. Oldfield, a newspaper reported, escaped by a miracle as his machine was reduced to a mass of tangled iron and wood. That more people were not killed or maimed is a cause for wonder. Cocky and gifted, a man who loved women as much as machines, Oldfield would maim and kill many more before the end of his career. As Oldfield recovered from his injuries, the repaired Aero took the starting flag in Milwaukee a week after the luckless Ohio man's death. Promising young racer Frank Day was at the tiller, but the Aero proved too much to manage, and he spun out. Ford's racer rolled end over end, landing on the unfortunate chauffeur, grinding him into the ground, an unrecognizable mess, a paper reported. For those who did not share autoists' enthusiasm, and there were many who did not, influential politicians, judges, and editorialists among them, Day's death was new cause for condemnation. "We saw the young man who rode to his death on the day preceding the fatality," the Wisconsin State Journal opined. "A cleaner, fresher youth never delighted his parents' eyes. The wind tousled his abundant hair on his clear forehead as he whirled about the track. Determination and enthusiasm were in his eyes. The cheers of the impassioned mob impelled him as soldiers go to certain death under martial music." And then, an unrecognizable mess. "We are not wholesome enough to enjoy the triumphs of the soil and noble horses and royal-blooded cattle," the State Journal proclaimed. "The incident is a disgrace." For Ford, it was a disquieting but momentary setback. Back in Michigan, he rebuilt Arrow once again. He had further use for its awesome power. Pure speed was not the only lure for the spectators in their gloves and fur-trimmed coats at Lake St. Clair on that January day in 1904. In the first half-decade of what would be called the American century, railroads, ships, bicycles, horses, and horse-drawn vehicles still transported most people and goods. But the country was witnessing an astonishing proliferation of horseless carriage manufacturers and models. Every new entry seemed to generate buzz. Whether you liked cars or hated them, lived in a city where they swarmed the streets, or in the country where they were rarely, if ever, seen, you could hardly get through a day without talking about them. Car making had started in earnest in America just a decade before, with bicycle maker Charles E. Duryea, 31, in partnership with his 24-year-old mechanic brother, J. Frank, the first Americans to publicly declare their intention of creating a commercial enterprise from building and selling cars, contraptions most folks at the time thought were cobbled together by men possessing more free time than common sense. In September 1893, in Springfield, Massachusetts, Frank completed construction of a vehicle that married a custom-built single-cylinder gasoline motor to a horse-drawn Phaeton buggy purchased second-hand for $70. Shortly before he road-tested the car, Frank granted an interview to the Springfield Evening Union, which published a story on September 16, 1893, under the headline, "No Use for Horses. Springfield Mechanics Devise a New Mode of Travel, Ingenious Wagon Being Made in This City for Which the Makers Claim Great Things." A new motor carriage, when, if the preliminary tests prove successful as expected, will revolutionize the mode of travel on highways and do away with the horse as a means of transportation, is being made in this city, the reporter wrote. It is quite probable that within a short period of time, one may be able to see an ordinary carriage in almost every respect running along the streets or climbing country hills without visible means of propulsion. Frank was more than a good pitchman. The car he had built with his brother's help and the support of lone financial backer Irwin F. Markham, a nurse who had invested $1,000 in the Duryeas, did indeed succeed its first time on the road. On the afternoon of September 20th, the vehicle was hauled by horse from Frank's machine shop to a friend's yard on the outskirts of the city. The next morning, Frank took a streetcar out to the neighborhood. As he rode, he fantasized that once well started on the open road, the machine would roll along sweetly for at least a mile or two. With this pleasant thought in mind, I enthusiastically pushed the car from under the apple tree. Frank started the engine, and his car chugged onto Spruce Street. America's first gasoline automobile had now appeared, he would recall. It had done what it was designed and built to do, in that it carried the driver on the road and had been steered in the direction the driver wished to go. The car only traveled about 100 feet before stalling, but it restarted quickly, and each time again after successive stallings, providing sufficient encouragement for the Duryeas to continue. By March 1895, they had a smoother operating machine that successfully completed an 18-mile round trip to Westfield, Massachusetts, along rough, steep, horse-ravaged roads, a feat that suggested the brothers really were onto something. On September 21st, 1895, they incorporated the Duryea Motor Wagon Company. Those who have taken the pains to search below the surface for the great tendencies of the age know that a giant industry is struggling into being, wrote the editor of The Horseless Age, America's second automobile journal, in its inaugural issue, published in November 1895. It is often said that a civilization may be measured by its facilities of locomotion. If this is true, as seems abundantly proved by present facts and the testimony of history, the new civilization that is rolling in with the horseless carriage will be higher civilization than the one that you enjoy. Like the Horseless Age's editor, the growing ranks of motorists saw the car as the future, along with the locomotive, the telegram, photography, and electricity. It was a technology that would move mankind valiantly forward. They envisioned a day when a motorist could comfortably drive from east coast to west and all points between, when everyone could and would own a car. This vision of the future seemed fairly delusional to the naysayers, whose numbers grew as the 19th century gave way to the 20th. They viewed the gas or steam-powered car, by whatever name, as a loud, dangerous, and polluting fiend that threatened the social fabric, an enemy of God-fearing people and noble horses. They dismissed the car, however propelled, as a fad soon to fade. Common sense alone told you it couldn't last. In those early days, most cars were so finicky that repair kits were included as standard features, and wealthy owners hired mechanics to ride with them. Many cars had no cabins, roofs, headlamps, or doors. They could explode or burst into flame for no apparent reason. As gasoline tanks and lead sometimes leak, and the fluid more rarely becomes ignited, the automobile, a leading weekly wrote, it is a wise precaution on the part of the automobilist to carry a fire extinguisher in the car for such emergencies. Even though it may never be required, it will add something to the driver's feeling of security, and should it ever be wanted, it will, like a revolver in the West, be wanted badly. And if the machine itself was at a primitive stage of development, the experience of motoring was cruder still. No training, registration, or licenses to drive were required in most jurisdictions. There were few stop signs and no traffic lights. Accidents that injured or killed motorists and pedestrians abounded. Only a tiny percentage of U.S. roads were hard-surfaced. Service stations were scarce, gasoline rare in the outskirts and smaller cities, maps unreliable or non-existent. Motorists venturing off the beaten path were advised to carry guns for protection against wildlife, irate horse-loving citizens, and ornery constables determined to avenge the evil of the new machine. Regardless, the car was a siren's call to inventors, entrepreneurs, and all manner of tinkerers. In America, as in Europe, a new sort of gold rush was underway. Like the Duryea's, some of the new manufacturers had been building bicycles before falling under the spell of the self-propelled machine. Horse-drawn carriage builders also sensed opportunity, as did blacksmiths, shipbuilders, sewing machine makers, and many others. Unlike the railroad, petroleum, coal, and steel industries, the cost of entry was minimal. Not even a technical background was required, at least to stake a claim. In March 1901, an industry publication reported that the Reverend H.A. France of Cherryville, Pennsylvania, believes he has received a call to the motor trade and will henceforth make petrol cars in place of sermons. This was an era when many car companies managed to build just a single vehicle or two a year, and annual production of a few dozen was cause for hallelujah. The Duryea Brothers Duryea Motor Wagon Company, the first U.S. firm to serially produce a car, built and sold just 13 vehicles during its first full year of operation, 1896. Sales were sporadic after that, and in 1898, with Frank and Charles feuding, the company went out of business. This was by far the most common story of the early era. According to calculations Charles Duryea made in 1909, in the years 1900 to 1908, 502 U.S. car makers went into business, an average of 55 a year, or more than one a week. Of that total, 273 failed, and another 29 went into some other field, a failure rate of greater than 60%. Given his obsession with machines and his gift for building and improving them, Henry Ford seemed to have decent odds for enduring success. His business record, however, suggested he had much to learn. Two previous companies he'd started had failed, and rival firms, particularly industry leader Olds Motor Works, whose founder Ransom Eli Olds was also greatly mechanically gifted, were already building devoted followings. Ford needed more than just a good car to succeed. In this frenzied period, so intense with competition, he needed attention. Speed records and racing got attention. The winter sun shone weakly, bringing no warmth to the people lining the shore near the front porch of the Hotel Chesterfield. Among them were Ford's wife, Clara, and the couple's only child, their 10-year-old son, Edsel. The Chesterfield, since it first opened in 1900, was one of the finest establishments in the resort community of New Baltimore. Known for its mineral baths, opera house, saloons, and bathing, fishing, and sailing on Anchor Bay, just an hour by rail from Detroit. It offered the best food and amenities, including electric lights and steam heat throughout. Here was a clientele that might buy a Ford car. Possibly a potential investor or two was lurking in the crowd that second Saturday of January 1904. A much larger audience would read about Ford's attempt in the newspapers, thanks to the reporters on hand. The ice boat races Ford had arranged as a sort of opening act ended, and the aero race car was brought onto the ice. Ugly and weird, it looked as though it had been concocted by someone who had failed his mechanics apprenticeship and taken to whiskey, not by an engineering genius. How else to explain its steel-reinforced frame, spoke wheels, single seat, and bewildering arrangement of exposed wires, gears, levers, and controls, all in the service of an open motor that occupied nearly half the length of the vehicle and drenched the driver in oil and grease when it fired, for it had no oil pan or engine compartment. Men hired by Ford had cleared a 15-foot-wide strip of ice 4 miles long on Anchor Bay, then coated it with cinders from the coal-fired power plant north of the Hotel Chesterfield. The first 2 miles would allow aero to come up to speed, the third mile would be timed, and the last was for deceleration. The event would have been easier, not to mention warmer, on the long, flat sands of Ormond Beach, Florida, just north of Daytona, future birthplace of NASCAR, where car racing was already enormously popular. But the auto show at New York's Madison Square Garden, America's largest, began the next weekend, before the start of the Daytona season. Ford hoped to arrive in Manhattan with a headline-making story of the incredible cars he could build. Assuming no tragic accident occurred, that is. A thought that, when Ford walked onto the ice, left him uncharacteristically unnerved. But it was too late to stop. If I had called off the trial, he later said, we would have secured an immense amount of the wrong kind of advertising. Starting any car in 1904 was never easy, but firing in sub-freezing temperatures one of the largest automobile engines ever built was akin to raising the dead. Ford called on Edward S. Spider Huff, one of a small group of employees whose mechanical skills and ingenuity rivaled the boss's. So valuable was Huff to Ford that the boss not only forgave him his habit of chewing tobacco, which Ford loathed, but allowed him to install a spittoon in his car. He also overlooked Spider's disappearances for days inside houses of ill repute, where he sought relief from his recurring depression. Spider warmed parts of aero with a blowtorch and poured hot water into the cooling system to help coax the beast to life. A spectator volunteered to hand crank the open engine, whose cast iron heart was 4 massive 7x7-inch cylinders. The motor caught with a thunder that rattled the windows of the Hotel Chesterfield. Flame shot from aero's exhausts, and oil sprayed everywhere. The roar of those cylinders alone was enough to half kill a man, Ford said the first time they had been fired. More shock had awaited when he took aero and 999 onto the test track on their maiden runs. We let them out at full speed, he said. I cannot quite describe the sensation. Going over Niagara Falls would have been but a pastime after a ride in one of them. Ford took his seat. A warm-up revealed something no test course or track had predicted. When the car hit fissures in the ice, the impact rattled the vehicle so violently that the driver could not keep a steady hand on the gas. Ford would never be able to bring aero full throttle alone. Spider would have to ride with him, one hand controlling the gas and the other holding on, while hunkered down on the floorboards. There was no other place on the race car. There was only one seat, Ford said. The afternoon was advancing, the January sun weakening. The American Automobile Association, the AAA, had agreed to officially certify the race, but the organization's three-timers were tardy, and Ford decided to make a run without them. His speed would not be official, but at least he'd have a number. As the ice boat circled, Spider and Ford drove to the start of the four-mile course. Men with stopwatches stood ready. Spider leaned on the gas and Arrow rocketed down the ice. This time, the fishers did more than rattle and shake. They launched the car repeatedly into the air. The laws of physics were being tested, but Ford and Spider miraculously maintained control. Some 4 minutes later, they coasted to a stop. A speed of 100 miles an hour had been clocked. That indeed buried the existing mark of 84.732 miles per hour, set on solid ground 2 months before by Arthur Duray, a 21-year-old who drove a French-built stock car that its manufacturer claimed could run not just on gasoline, but also on gin or brandy, presumably an enticement to the upper-class buyer in those twilight days of the Gilded Age. Duray's record was the latest in a series of officially sanctioned advances that dated back to 1898, when a wedge-shaped, battery-powered vehicle had reached 39.2 miles per hour, about as fast as a thoroughbred could gallop. But Ford's mark was not official. The AAA timekeepers had not arrived. When they finally did, Ford brought Arrow back to the start of the course, but the car's 225-pound flywheel whirred loose, nearly hitting him and Spider. Ford narrowly escaped with his life, wrote the Detroit Journal, which called Ford a mechanic who began to design automobiles several years ago, when the craze for them began. Repairs could not be accomplished in the waning light, and the contest was postponed until Tuesday afternoon, January 12th. With luck, Ford might still make it to New York a hero. A Michigan Wolverine. There is no evidence that Frederic L. Smith was present at Anchor Bay on January 9th, 1904, but he surely paid attention. He had Ford locked in his crosshairs. Son of Samuel L. Smith, a Michigan magnate who had made his fortune in lumber, shipping, mining, and railroads, Fred Smith was a wiry man who tended to smirk rather than smile. A member of the Detroit Athletic Club and the city's fellow craft club, elite places Ford would never frequent, even if he'd been invited, he was more comfortable in a boardroom than in a machine shop or on the factory floor. He did not dirty his hands, and he certainly could not have made a carburetor or a piston, yet he professed superior knowledge of an industry built with wrenches and sweat. He had been raised in privilege, the sort of background that Ford, son of a farmer, did not much appreciate either. Smith was, in short, the classic suit. After graduating in 1886 from Michigan Military Academy, an expensive institution in the Tony Detroit suburb of Orchard Lake Village, Smith enrolled at the University of Michigan, where he joined the Xi chapter of the Zeta Psi fraternity and served on the Junior Hop Committee. He played sports, winning the lightweight wrestling championship and quarterbacking the 1888 Wolverines, which began their season on a 4-year undefeated streak, during which they'd outscored opponents 258-12. Michigan played only a handful of games each year during that period, but the Wolverines, nonetheless, were so celebrated that no less than future President Theodore Roosevelt praised the team in a speech in October 1888 in Ann Arbor. Smith achieved his first national prominence when, on November 29th of that year, the Wolverines competed in a football game against the Chicago University Club, played on the home field of the Chicago National League Ball Club, later the Chicago Cubs, that dazzled reporters. 3,000 persons, largely drawn from the most fashionable people of Chicago, witnessed this afternoon what was undoubtedly the greatest football event that ever took place in the West, wrote the New York Times, one of several papers to cover the game. Smith was just 18 years old. Was the young man's ego swelled by the fanfare? Or was he humiliated when his team lost 26-4, breaking Michigan's almost 5-year undefeated run? Whatever the case, he did not play football for Michigan again. After he graduated in 1890, his father sent him overseas for 2 years' study at the University of Berlin. He returned home in 1892 to a job in Samuel's businesses. In 1897, those businesses included Olds Motor Works, the company founded by the pioneering Ransom Olds, in which Samuel had bought $510 shares. In 1899, Samuel, by now majority stockholder, was elected president. His son Fred, not yet 30, was elected secretary treasurer. The post seemed a stretch for a legacy child not long out of college, but the Smiths held the winning hand. And Olds had a winning car, its curved dash model, far and away the best-selling automobile in America as 1904 began. Named for the resemblance its nose bore to a sleigh, the 7-horsepower curved dash sold for an affordable $650, about $17,000 in today's dollars, approximately the cost of a subcompact, and was marketed as a dependable and technologically superior machine, the highest achievement in mechanical genius and skill, the best thing on wheels, as one ad proclaimed. In what may have been the first use of sex appeal to sell automobiles, Olds also aimed for the hearts of young ladies and the wallets of young men by casting the curved dash as romantic. So effective was this marketing that the car was the subject of a hit song, In My Merry Oldsmobile, which teased of more than horseless transportation. Young Johnny Steele has an Oldsmobile. He loves his dear little girl. She is the queen of his gas machine. She has his heart in a whirl. They love to spark in the dark old park as they go flying along. The company seemed to have found the Midas touch, but nothing was forever or even very long in this volatile new industry, Fred Smith well understood. Ford, he had concluded, represented an unusually grave threat. He was tireless and obsessed, and he clearly had his eye on the popular market that the curved dash then dominated. Like many cars of the time, the Model A, the first offering from Ford's third company, lacked the reliability that consumers wanted. But in other respects, it was more appealing than the curved dash. The Model A had a steering wheel, not a tiller. Its 8-horsepower engine, one more than the Olds, supported a top speed of about 30 miles per hour, a bit faster than the curved dash. It cost $200 more than Olds' staple car, but all in all, it could be presented as a better value. Painted a jaunty red with black leather seats and brass trim all over, the Model A was also pretty. For the money, the car was a good value. Ford's car had been on the market only a few days when, on July 26, 1903, Smith tossed a bomb. That day, the Detroit News published his 2-column ad, warning that any person making, selling, or using automobiles that did not carry the Selden patent, U.S. patent number 549160, which claimed invention of the gas-powered automobile, will be liable to prosecution for infringement. The patent holder, the New York-based Association of Licensed Automobile Manufacturers, maintained that no automobile with a gasoline engine, whether manufactured in the United States or abroad, could be sold domestically without paying royalties to the ALAM. As its first president, Fred Smith controlled the New York group. Ford fired back almost immediately. In an advertisement 2 days later in the Detroit Free Press, he promised dealers, importers, agents, and users of our gasoline automobiles that the Ford Motor Company would protect you against any prosecution for alleged infringements of patents. Ford continued with a taunt. We are the pioneers of the gasoline automobile. Our Mr. Ford also built the famous 999 gasoline automobile, which was driven by Barney Oldfield in New York on July 25, 1903, a mile in 55 4/5 seconds on a circular track, which is the world's record. Mr. Ford, driving his own machine, beat Mr. Winton at Grosse Pointe Track in 1901. We have always been winners. On October 22, 1903, Smith's group filed suit against Ford in a New York City federal court. On November 5th, the company that had purchased Ford cars was second to be sued, and on December 28th, two French firms, Panard et Levasseur and André Massénat, were brought to court. Many more suits would follow. Smith was determined to force Ford from business. He probably at that point did not understand what kind of enemy he had made. Their appetite whetted by the excitement of Ford's unofficial record-breaking performance the previous Saturday, a crowd of more than 1,000 assembled at Anchor Bay on the following Tuesday, January 12, 1904. By 3 p.m., the temperature had climbed to almost 30 degrees Fahrenheit. Workers cleared the inch of fresh snow that had fallen. The AAA timekeepers took their posts. Aero idled at the starting line. The timers with their stopwatches and checkered flags signaled their readiness, and Spider leaned on the gas. The people lining the measured mile watched the car accelerate, a speck in the distance heading their way, the Chicago-based Motorage Weekly said. As the car reached full throttle, it again repeatedly lifted into the air, forcing Ford to white-knuckle it back into control, which put Aero on a zigzag trajectory, not the desired straight line. Twice, the puffing machine, as one paper described it, swerved altogether from the cleared ice, plowing through snowbanks and momentarily disappearing in clouds of white. Ford had gone past the point of reason, but Spider kept his hand on the gas. Aero completed the measured mile. After nearly ramming a boat frozen into the ice, it overshot the final mile, plunging through a snowbank and spinning to a stop. The AAA timekeepers checked their watches. 1 mile in 39.4 seconds. That was 91.37 miles per hour, an officially sanctioned new world record. Ford and Spider parked their racer. One paper reported that the men looked a bit pale, but when he spoke to the press, Ford was composed, albeit an oily mess. The beauty of the race is the fact that we were scarcely in danger, although we were literally flying through the air, he told the Detroit Free Press. Scarcely in danger, indeed. A full-page ad Ford placed the next day in the Horseless Age detailed the fastest time ever made with an automobile on any racetrack in the world, a record achieved in a Ford machine. Lest there be doubt as to authenticity, the ad noted that the AAA, the official sanctioning body, had clocked the run with three watches at the start and three at the finish. Ford is king, the ad declared. Inside Old's Motor Works, Fred Smith really was king. He had just pulled off the most stunning coup American motor making had ever witnessed. 2. Native Sons. Engines. The Civil War was 4 years along when Ransom Eli Olds, the youngest of Sarah Whipple and Pliny Fisk Olds's five children, was born in Geneva, Illinois on June 3, 1864. Pliny was a blacksmith, but he did not prosper early at his trade, and in 1870 he moved his family to Cleveland and took a job as superintendent of an ironworks that constructed bridges and buildings. That lasted 4 years. He farmed during the next 4 years on property outside Cleveland, returning to the city in 1878 to take a job as a pattern maker. 2 years later, he brought his family to Lansing, Michigan, where he opened up a machine shop. Pliny's mechanical talents influenced his youngest child, a shy boy who enjoyed visiting the ironworks and later watching his father in the small shop he built on the farm. But agriculture was not for Ransom. He hated especially the smell of horses and did not see his future in building or servicing vehicles that were powered by them or using them to work a farm. He wanted a role in his father's Lansing machine shop, P.F. Olds & Son, founded with his older brother Wallace, his partner. Ransom worked part-time from the firm's beginning, the year he turned 16, and he was full-time by 1883, while he was still a teen. 2 years later, he bought out his brother's interest. By then, the company had achieved a reputation as practical machinists, an ad from the period said, and also as a manufacturer of steam yachts and vertical steam engines of 3, 5, and 10 horsepower. Soon, P.F. Olds and Son was building steam engines that produced 12, 25, and 60 horsepower. Ransom, whose ambition and inventiveness had outstripped his father's, began to imagine connecting one of them to a carriage. He later recalled that he designed several such crude automobiles in his head before putting a plan on paper. "I could almost see myself flying down the street," he remembered. In 1887, Olds began to construct his first horseless carriage, a three-wheeled wood and steel vehicle that was steered with a tiller and powered by one of P.F. Olds and Son's one-horsepower steam engines. Word spread through Lansing of the strange machine being built, and curious residents stopped by the shop to watch its progress. But Ransom, wishing to avoid embarrassment if he failed, wanted no witness to the first drive. Before dawn one day in the summer of 1887, he fired up the engine and motored out of his shop. "I had but little trouble reaching the road and running a block without a stop," he later recalled. At this point, the efforts of the engine were exhausted, and an assistant was necessary, as it was getting quite light and there was no more time to be lost. I secured two pushers behind, and together with the engine, got it back without an accident, which ended my first trip in a horseless carriage. Little discouraged, Olds built a second, more powerful steam-powered car. Completed by early 1892, this one had four wheels and ran more smoothly. Olds claimed ease of operation and a usual speed of 15 miles an hour for the 1,200-pound vehicle, and he managed to get coverage in Scientific American, the widely read and respected New York-based journal in which P.F. Olds and Son already advertised. The May 21, 1893 Scientific American story was reprinted in a carriage trade journal that came to the attention of an English company, which bought the car for $400 and shipped it to a branch office in India, apparently the first export of a U.S.-built automobile. Here was a lesson in another kind of power, the power of the press to move product. Olds might have continued down the steam car path if not for his visit to the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, where he saw gasoline engines on display, as well as a gas-powered automobile built by Carl Friedrich Benz, a German engineer and inventor. The future, he concluded, did not lie with P.F. Olds and Son's signature steam engines. No one person invented the automobile or the engines that powered it. Like every complex technology, it resulted from the evolutionary contributions of many individuals, some working together and others apart. The earliest automobile pioneers were active during the first industrial revolution, which began in Great Britain in the 1700s and spread to the European continent and then America. Steam, which replaced water power used in early factories, was the first energy form to move a horseless carriage. In about 1770, the French artillery office and engineer Nicolas-Joseph Cugnot built what is recognized as the first self-propelled vehicle, a three-wheel steam-powered tractor that he envisioned pulling military cannons. Scottish engineer William Murdoch built a similar steam-powered carriage, or road locomotive, in 1784, and Cornish engineer Richard Trevithick followed Murdoch's lead in 1801 when he built Puffing Dragon, a large boiler mounted on wheels, and an improved model, the London steam carriage, 2 years later. Gas entered the picture for good in 1860, when the Belgian engineer Jean-Joseph Étienne Lenoir, following experiments by others in Europe and America, patented a two-stroke coal-gas-fired engine, which he used to propel a carriage. After reading reports of Lenoir's engine, a young German named Nikolaus August Otto designed one of his own, and in partnership with the businessman Eugen Langen, made further improvements. Awarded the gold medal at the International Exposition of 1867, held in Paris, the Otto engine went into large-scale production in 1872, when Langen established his Deutz gas engine factory. For chief engineer, Langen hired fellow countryman Gottlieb Wilhelm Daimler. By 1875, the company was producing 90 engines a month. The engines were used to power equipment, not carriages at the time, but their revolutionary nature, small size compared to steam, and sturdy performance made them appealing. In America, meanwhile, George B. Brayton had been building a similar motor. An Englishman living in Boston, Brayton was apparently the first to use petroleum instead of coal gas or other fuel to fire an internal combustion engine. With the discovery of oil near Titusville, Pennsylvania in 1859, an industry that would become symbiotic with motor vehicle manufacturing had been born. Inevitably, inventors saw the new internal combustion engine as suitable for powering a horseless carriage. The first, apparently, was the German-Austrian Siegfried Marcus, who built an engine of his own and attached it to a four-wheel carriage in about 1864. Fearing the police, he drove it around the streets of Vienna under cloak of darkness, but the noise could not be hidden, and it attracted the authorities, who ordered Marcus to stop his experiments. The next two decades saw greater progress, and it was Benz and Daimler who led the way. Daimler had begun to imagine a self-propelled vehicle during his early days working for Langen and Otto, and when he left the company in 1882, he began to develop his own engine, which he used to power a wooden motorcycle that he patented in 1885. The next year, Daimler tested a carriage, his first car. He received patents for the machine in Germany and in France. Working separately, Benz, who also had been inspired by the Otto engine, mounted an engine to a tricycle. He tested it in 1885 and perfected it the next year, whereupon his Benz patent Motorwagen was granted German patent number 37435. The vehicle, wrote Neue Badische Landeszeitung on July 3, 1886, should prove itself quite practical and useful to doctors, travelers, and lovers of sport. Useful, perhaps, but these first automobiles from Daimler and Benz did not operate dependably and were not immediately popular. Steam carriages enjoyed greater favor, and electric vehicles, whose roots lay in the first half of the 19th century, were also being manufactured. And then two French citizens stepped in, setting the stage for their country to become the early global leader in automaking. Louise Sarrazin was the widow of Edouard Sarrazin, a lawyer for Deutz gas engine factory who had known Daimler and had been impressed by his brilliance. Edouard had been negotiating with Émile Levasseur and René Panard, owners of a carriage and woodworking factory in Paris, to sell Daimler's inventions in France when he became gravely ill. Before he died, he urged Louise to conclude the agreement. "You may have complete faith in Daimler's genius," he is reported to have said. "It has a future beyond anything we can now imagine." Louise heeded her husband's wishes and signed with Panard et Levasseur, which exhibited two road carriages and a streetcar using Daimler engines at the 1889 Paris Exposition. Louise and Panard were soon more than business partners. They married on May 17, 1890. Panard et Levasseur began commercial production, which it supported with clever marketing, including a catalog of its vehicles published in January 1892 and a leaflet with customer testimonials published that October. Benz also discovered opportunity in France, when in early 1888, French engineer Émile Roger visited him at his Mannheim factory. Roger bought a patent Motorwagen and secured the rights to sell it outside Germany, in France, under the name Roger Benz, which, he had decided, would not turn off potential customers who might be offended by a purely German name. France's defeat in the 1870 Franco-Prussian War still smarted. A Benz was exhibited at the 1889 Paris Exposition and 4 years later in Chicago. By then, other French firms were making cars, most famously Peugeot, which displayed a three-wheel steam-powered car at the 1889 Paris Exposition, and the next year abandoned steam in favor of a gas-powered four-wheel car. Imported German engineering was not the only factor in making France the epicenter of the new industry. Thanks to Napoleon Bonaparte's ambitious public works projects, France boasted superior roads and bridges. Reports of French cars reached America, where native inventors were working on machines of their own. Scientific American, first published in 1845, was among those carrying stories of the wonders abroad. But it would take two automobile races to truly ignite the industry in Europe and across the Atlantic. Tinkering. Like Ransom Olds, Henry Ford hated farming. And like Olds, Ford, born July 30, 1863, to a farmer and his wife whose 90-acre homestead was on the outskirts of Detroit, showed mechanical aptitude early in life. His interest in machinery displeased his father, William, an Irish immigrant married to Larry Littegott Ford, an orphaned carpenter's daughter who had been raised by neighbors. "From the beginning, I never could work up much interest in the labor of farming," Ford later wrote. "I want to have something to do with machinery." My father was not entirely in sympathy with my bent toward mechanics. He thought I ought to be a farmer. Ford complained of too much hard hand labor in agriculture during that period after the Civil War. "It was life on the farm that drove me into devising ways and means to better transportation." Ford's favorite childhood toys were not tops or marbles, but tools and odds and ends of metal with which he played in a small workshop. "Every fragment of machinery was a treasure," he said. The young boy kept his pockets filled with washers and nuts, and at the age of 13, he took a broken watch apart and successfully repaired it. Soon, he claimed, he could repair any watch. He learned by tinkering, a habit that would serve him well when he began working on bigger devices. "There is an immense amount to be learned simply by tinkering with things," Ford declared. "It is not possible to learn from books how everything is made, and a real mechanic ought to know how nearly everything is made." One day around the time that he first fixed a watch, Ford encountered the first vehicle he had seen that was not powered by a horse. It was a road locomotive, a giant steam-powered machine built by Nichols, Shepherd, and Company of Battle Creek that crawled on steel wheels from farm to farm, providing portable power for threshing and other agricultural tasks. The driver had pulled the machine over to let Ford and his father in their horse-drawn wagon pass, but before William could stop him, Henry had hopped off and met the locomotive's engineer, a friendly sort who was delighted to explain how his machine worked. The encounter profoundly impressed the boy. "It was that engine which took me into automotive transportation," Ford later wrote in his autobiography, My Life and Work. At school, the boy experimented with building a steam turbine and a forge. In late 1879, his formal studies finished, the 17-year-old left for Detroit, where he apprenticed by day at a machine shop and repaired watches and clocks by night. His father did not endorse his choice. "I was all but given up for lost," Ford would recall. But William no longer had such a strong hold on him, and his beloved mother, who might have persuaded him to remain on the farm, had died 3 years before. In the summer of 1880, Ford took a new apprenticeship at Detroit Dry Dock Company, largest of the city's shipbuilding firms. Working in the engine works department, he completed his three-year apprenticeship and then took a job with Westinghouse Engine Company, which made road locomotives like the one that had fascinated him as a boy. And then he married a young woman named Clara Alla Bryant. Lured by his father, who owned a tract of uncut timber near his farm, he settled with his new wife in a small house and operated a sawmill, which provided a modest income for the newlyweds. But engines still called Ford. He built small gasoline ones in his home shop and read what he could about the emerging technology. In 1891, the offer of a position that paid well as an engineer with the Detroit Edison Illuminating Company brought him with Clara back to the city. Again, he worked days at his job and experimented at night and on weekends in the shop he built in a shed by his house. The papers and trade journals were carrying reports of the horseless carriage, and Ford wanted in. By late 1893, Ford had built a small experimental gas-powered engine that might be the progenitor of a larger motor that could propel a car. Following supper on that Christmas Eve, he brought it into the kitchen, secured it on the sink, and asked Clara for help in starting it. His wife dripped gasoline into a metal cup that served as a carburetor and followed his directions in adjusting the intake valve as he turned the flywheel. As house current delivered electricity to the engine's primitive spark plug, the kitchen lights flickered, but the motor started in a burst of flames and vibration. Ford let it run for several minutes, satisfied that he had the basics of a working design that he could incorporate into a larger version. By 1895, Ford, with the assistance of Spider Huff and a few others, was building his first car from parts he made, scrounged, and bought. He did not have the benefit of blueprints for this vehicle, which he called the quadricycle, except for the plans he himself drew up. "I had to work from the ground up," Ford said. "That is, although I knew that a number of people were working on horseless carriages, I could not know what they were doing." He was a man obsessed, and his obsession strained the finances of the family. But Clara supported her husband, and he kept going. As 1896 began, Ford knew the day would soon arrive when he would be able to test drive the quadricycle. French roads were suited for speed, and the Parisian daily newspaper, Le Petit Journal, took advantage on July 19, 1894, when it sponsored the world's first automobile competition, a race from Paris to Rouen. More than 100 vehicles were entered, but only 21 started. A steam-powered French De Dion Bouton placed first, covering the nearly 80 miles in 6 hours and 48 minutes, an average speed of about 12 miles per hour. Two Panhards and two Peugeots rounded out the top five. A Benz placed 14th. The contest and the 4 days of qualifying and exhibition surrounding it generated exciting headlines that proved a boon for the young industry, inspiring a committee of journalists and manufacturers to stage a more ambitious competition the next June, a true race from Paris to Bordeaux and back, a distance of 732 miles. Driving one of his Panhards, Levasseur placed first, covering the course in just under 48 hours. Peugeots took the second through fourth spots, with the Benz finishing fifth. Lunching at his club in Chicago one day not long after, Herman H. Kolzat, publisher of the Chicago Times-Herald, happened upon a copy of the French weekly L'Illustration that featured photographs of the race. Imagine if the car really caught on in America just as it had in Europe, as some were predicting. The advertising revenues might rival the cash flow from ads for clothes, cosmetics, soaps, beverages, bicycles, restaurants, hotels, and other consumer goods and services that were proliferating as the 19th century drew to a close. And how better to push things along than to sponsor a race in Chicago, where bicycle and horse competitions enjoyed great popularity, and the sensation of the magnificent 1893 Chicago World's Fair still resonated. Kolzat managed to get the attention of President Grover Cleveland, persuading him that the development of horseless carriages someday would benefit the army, and that a highly publicized race, modeled after the ones in France, would spur that development. Cleveland assigned a general to assist the publisher in planning the contest, the first on American soil. Kolzat offered a $5,000 purse, nearly $150,000 in 2014 dollars, and an equal amount to cover racers' expenses. A 100-mile route in and around Chicago was advertised, although that was an exaggeration. The actual length was 92 miles. The race was scheduled for November 2, 1895. Equal parts showman and journalist, Kolzat also sponsored a readers' contest with a $500 prize to suggest the best name for the motor vehicle. Horseless carriage, vehicle motor, automobile carriage, motorcycle, and automobile, borrowed from the French, were among the submitted names. The Times-Herald declared motorcycle the winner, but it was not a word that would catch on. Automobile would, along with car, a derivative of C-A-R-R-E, meaning wheeled vehicle, which also had ancient French and Latin roots. Of the more than 75 cars that had entered Kohlzaat's race, only two made it to the starting line on November 2nd. A new Duryea, the second made by Frank and his brother, and an imported Benz that had been modified by Hieronymus A. Mueller, a prodigious inventor who operated a shop with his sons in Decatur, Illinois. Kohlzaat postponed the official race until Thanksgiving Day, November 28th, when he hoped more cars would make the effort, but he allowed the Duryea and the modified Benz to compete in a two-car consolation event. With Mueller's son Oscar driving, the Mueller Benz beat the Duryea, driven by Frank, with brother Charles, his passenger. On Thanksgiving morning, Chicagoans awoke to find several inches of snow. Just six cars assembled at the starting line at the Midway Plaisance of the former World's Fairgrounds. The Duryea, the Mueller Benz, and two other gas vehicles. Two electric-powered cars, a Sturgis, built in Chicago, and the Electroboat, built by a Philadelphia engineer and his chemist partner. With deteriorating road conditions, the route was shortened to 54 miles, from Chicago to Evanston and back. At 8:55 a.m., the race began. With Frank driving again and an umpire riding along, the Duryea took an early lead, lost it, and then gained it again when a competitor smashed into a horse-drawn taxi that refused to let it by. Frank lost 2 miles when he took a wrong turn, and more time when a steering gear broke, but he managed to get back into the race and once more take the lead. Dark was falling on a cold, wet night, sending the crowds home, just a sleigh or two on the snowy streets, when the Duryea neared the end. Only a local reporter was on hand to see the car as it motored through Douglas Park and down South California Avenue, the finish line within striking distance. Lacking spectators except here and there, the journal Autocar reported, a solitary watchman at one of the ill-smelling soap factories of the district hastening to his odorous place of duty, the men on the motor gave vent to war whoops, cheers, catcalls, and other manifestations of joy over the victory they were winning. After stopping for 4 minutes while a train crossed, the Duryea won the race at 7:18 p.m. An hour and 35 minutes later, the Mueller Benz finished second. Newspapers everywhere published accounts of the race, emphasizing the American triumph over the modified European import. The young industry generally benefited from the publicity, but second-place Mueller Benz would not get much value. The company built just 5 vehicles before it folded. In the wake of a gasoline explosion that killed founder Mueller on March 1, 1900, in his shop. Back home in Lansing after the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, Ransom Olds, in full control of the company now that his father had essentially retired, began development of a gas engine. In 1895, he applied for a patent, which was granted the following year. The engine was a commercial success, substantially increasing company revenues and supporting a 10,000-square-foot addition to the factory. Olds later recalled that sales for the engine itself were so robust that meeting demand hindered work on a vehicle, his own version of Benz's machine, to be powered by his own Olds gas engine. He found time in 1896 when he constructed a 2-seat, single-cylinder, 5-horsepower car with solid rubber tires, green body, red trim, and leather furnishings, a beauty of a vehicle, a local reporter wrote when Olds demonstrated the car for him that August. There is no doubt that the much-mooted question of the horseless carriage has been successfully solved, the reporter declared. Word spread, and soon other newspapers and magazines also were trumpeting the car. Probably the most successful vehicle of its kind ever turned out, wrote the Detroit Free Press. Said to work to perfection, and Olds's friends predict that it will come into general use, declared the Grand Rapids Democrat. An ad announcing that Olds's motorcycle was available for sale appeared later in 1896. The car cost $1,000 and was offered with 1 or 2 seats. The manufacture of gas engines, not vehicles, remained the company's bread and butter, but Ransom remained fascinated with automobiles. Intuiting the marketing value of a real-life demonstration of a car, he continued to drive his motorcycle through the streets of Lansing, so prominently that a newspaper claimed nearly every resident of the city was doubtless familiar with the machine. One of the residents was the wealthy Edward W. Sparrow, an Irish immigrant who had made his money as a landlord, developer, and timber speculator. Sparrow had the means to gamble on the new machine, and he had faith in Ransom Olds, who had grown a small company into a big one, but who needed outside investment if he was to grow it bigger still and begin large-scale automobile production. On August 21, 1897, during a meeting in Sparrow's office, the Olds Motor Vehicle Company was organized. Capitalized at $50,000, the company issued 5,000 shares of stock valued at $10 apiece to investors. Ransom received half the shares. Sparrow and his friend, Samuel L. Smith, a copper and lumber magnate, each received 500. Sparrow was named president, with Ransom Olds becoming manager. In its first year, Olds Motor Vehicle Company built just 4 motor wagon vehicles. The year also saw the first in a dizzying succession of divisions, acquisitions, expansions, restructurings, and recapitalizations that by the end of 1899 left Samuel Smith and his sons in command of Olds Motor Works, as the company was by then called. Of its 35,000 shares of stock, Ransom and his father controlled just 7,625 in 1899, fewer than one-fourth. In January 1900, Olds was elected president, Samuel Smith vice president, and Smith's son Fred secretary treasurer. But titles meant less than large shares of stock. The Smith family owned a majority of the stock. Olds was no longer captain of his ship. Ransom and his mechanics kept designing cars. They produced an electric vehicle, selling it for $600, the same price as one of Olds's gasoline models. But the limitations of batteries discouraged Ransom from doing more with electricity. Having become one of the few men to build cars with all 3 types of power, he had concluded that gas was the future. An engine promising efficient gas mileage that powered a vehicle that was easy to operate would help entice buyers, he believed. For the moment, the Smiths were content to let Olds set overall direction. Certainly no respectable businessman could quibble with it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.